If one day you decided that you wanted to walk around the Earth, it would take you about 335 days. Well, as long as you never stop and keep a steady pace of about 5 kilometers per hour. Also, you would have to be able to walk on water since about 75% of Earth's surface is covered in oceans. Yeah, that's not very practical. Okay, so what if you wanted to walk to the moon? Just as a thought experiment, let's have some fun. On average, the moon is 384,400 kilometers away from Earth. So, if you could walk in space non-stop at 5 kilometers per hour, it would take you 3,203 days. That's almost 9 years, right? What if you wanted to walk to the sun? Well, the sun is about 93 million kilometers away from us, so that would take 2,123 years. So then, what if you wanted to walk all the way to Pluto? Pluto orbits the sun at an average distance of 5.9 billion kilometers. It would take you 1.3 million years to walk that distance. Alright, that's just a bit ridiculous by now, isn't it? But you see, what this little thought experiment shows us is that space is stupendously big. And we are very, very tiny. You may have heard that the sun makes up more than 99% of the mass of the solar system. Of the less than 1% that's not the sun, about two-thirds is the gas giant Jupiter. And the remaining third is mostly the other big planets, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. And then there's everything else. The small planets, dwarf planets, moons, comets, and asteroids. And us, you and me, and everyone you know and don't know, living our lives on no more than a fraction of the total mass of the solar system. More than a million Earths could fit inside the sun, and yet it's just a small common star. It would be swallowed up by about half of all stars observed so far. One of the largest known stars, UY Scuti, is a variable hypergiant that can fit 5 billion suns. If placed in the solar system instead of the sun, we would all be very dead, but it would also extend just beyond the orbit of Jupiter, which sits at about 780 million kilometers from the sun. For your reference, if you wanted to walk that distance, it would take 17,808 years of non-stop walking. There might be an even bigger star called Stevenson 218, a red hypergiant that could fit 10 billion suns. Because stars like these are rare and basically falling apart due to their size, they're hard to observe and accurately measure, so it's not certain that Stevenson 218 is actually that big. Either way, these incredibly enormous stars make our sun look like nothing more than a speck of dust. And as for the Earth, well, it's barely there. But stars aren't the biggest objects in the universe. That honor goes to black holes. Unlike planets and stars, there's quite literally no limit to how big black holes can become. The biggest class of black holes are the supermassive black holes. A famous one is the black hole M87 star at the core of the galaxy Messier 87, and it's the only black hole we have a picture of. Or rather, we have a picture of its accretion disk. The black hole itself is hiding in a dark shadow at the center, and it's big enough that it could fit the entire solar system inside of it. The largest black hole we know of is TON 618. It consumes so much matter, it shines as bright as 100 trillion stars, and it outshines the galaxy it's located in, 18 billion light years away. It's so big, it could fit 11 solar systems side by side. To be clear, this is not exactly how black holes work. Black hole physics are strange and complicated, and this is just to have a frame of reference to convey how enormous these objects can get. Scientists think even bigger black holes could exist, and they call them stupendously large black holes, with a mass 100 billion that of the sun or more. But so far, not one has been found. Let that sink in for a moment. Stupendously large black holes. But there are much bigger things in the universe. Enormous structures composed of clouds of cosmic dust, or many millions of stars, or even millions of galaxies. But first, let's take a look at how we measure distance in the universe. The light year. The distance light travels in 1 year, 9.46 trillion kilometers. Now what about our silly thought experiment? How long would it take to walk that distance? 219 million years, for just one light year. The nearest star to the Sun, Proxima Centauri, sits about 4 light years away. We are very slow. Even our fastest machines are slow. The fastest spacecraft ever launched from Earth was New Horizons, sent to explore Pluto and its neighborhood. New Horizons left our planet at a speed of 16.26 kilometers per second. That's 58,500 kilometers per hour. It took the probe 9 years to reach its destination. But even at the fastest speed possible, the speed of light, it takes a long time to get anywhere in the universe. If you want to see this demonstrated, you can go to the online art project If the Moon Were Only One Pixel, created by artist and web designer Josh Worth. This website effectively shows how far apart everything in the solar system is, with the moon at one pixel and everything else to that scale. You start at the Sun and can scroll all the way to Pluto. There's a button on the lower right corner you can click so the site will auto-scroll at light speed. Yeah, it's so much slower than you would think. At this speed, it'll take 8 minutes to reach planet Earth. If you want to sit and wait to reach Pluto, that'll take you about 5 hours. Everything in the solar system and all of the universe is so far apart. Even light speed is basically a snail's pace. Almost everything we see in the night sky is completely out of our reach, and it's all mind-bogglingly huge. The biggest nebula we know of is the Tarantula Nebula, located in the Large Magellanic Cloud, one of the Milky Way's small satellite galaxies, visible from the southern hemisphere. It's a giant stellar nursery where massive amounts of hydrogen gas are transformed into hundreds of thousands of brand new stars. The nebula is over 1,800 light years across. It's extremely bright. It's visible to the naked eye, even though it's 170,000 light years away from us. If you put it instead of the Orion Nebula, which is also visible to the naked eye but sits only 1,300 light-years away and is only 25 light-years across, the Tarantula Nebula would shine bright enough to cast shadows at night. It would cover as much as the night sky as 75 full moons placed side by side, and it would be visible during the day. But the Tarantula Nebula is still peanuts compared to entire galaxies. Our galaxy, the Milky Way, is quite big but still quite average for a galaxy. It's about 100,000 light-years in diameter. Our galactic neighbor, the Andromeda Galaxy, is twice as large, about 220,000 light-years across. Messier 87, you know, where that supermassive black hole is located that we managed to take a photo of, is much bigger, about 980,000 light-years in diameter. But the biggest galaxy we know of is called IC 1101. It stretches as wide as 5.5 million light-years, making it 50 times larger and about 2,000 times more massive than our own galactic home. A bunch of galaxies that are bound together by gravity is called a cluster. Our galaxy is part of the local group. That also includes Andromeda, the Triangulum Galaxy, and a whole bunch of smaller galaxies, and is roughly 10 million light-years across. The local group is a part of the Virgo supercluster that includes at least 100 other groups and clusters of galaxies. It's estimated to be about 110 million light-years in diameter. Virgo is a part of the Laniakea supercluster. Laniakea contains approximately 100,000 galaxies and is estimated to stretch for 520 million light-years. Laniakea is not the largest supercluster we know of. That could be, as far as we can tell, the Kalem supercluster. It's estimated to span 910 million light-years and contains 550,000 bigger and smaller galaxies. This is where the size of these things becomes difficult to measure. You see, we sit in the middle of all of this, and it's hard to gather all the data that would help us figure out the structure of the universe accurately. For one, the center of the Milky Way obstructs our view, and it will take 100 million years for Earth and the solar system to have moved to the other side of the galaxy so we can see what's out there. Imagine we are like a tiny ant sitting inside the crown of a gigantic tree. We can look at all the leaves and branches and try to map out how it's all connected. But we can't quite grasp what the whole tree actually looks like. All we can do is make educated guesses and throw lots of big numbers around. Our existence seems entirely insignificant. So then, what are the biggest structures in the universe? Now we can talk about galactic walls and supervoids. All the clusters and superclusters form galaxy filaments. These enormous thread-like formations following along strings of dark matter, referred to as the galactic web or cosmic web. Dark matter is a hypothetical form of matter thought to make up 85% of all matter in the universe. It doesn't appear to emit, absorb, or reflect any kind of electromagnetic radiation, so it's difficult to detect. But we know something is there because we can see the gravitational effect of dark matter. And it appears to shape all the galaxies in the universe in this web-like structure. One of the biggest galactic walls we know of is the Sloan Great Wall, and it's estimated to be 1.37 billion light-years in length. That is 1/60th of the total diameter of the observable universe. But the largest structure ever found is this humongous chain of galaxy clusters called the Hercules Corona Borealis Great Wall. It stretches for 10 billion light-years, supposedly, because there is still some controversy surrounding its discovery, and the people that found it are still researching it and gathering more data that support the existence of this incredibly huge formation. And so these galactic filaments or galactic walls are the absolute biggest formations we know of. And they are the boundaries between these voids, vast stretches of space that contain very few galaxies. Or none at all. The voids between the clusters and galactic walls typically have a diameter between 30 and 300 million light-years. But some voids are much bigger than that. One of them is the Boötes Void. It spans for 330 million light-years, and is referred to as a supervoid. It's not completely empty, but studies have shown that the Boötes Void contains only 60 galaxies in a space that would usually have about 2,000. According to astronomer Greg Aldring, the scale of the void is so enormous that if the Milky Way had been at the center, we wouldn't have known other galaxies exist until the 1960s. Maybe there are blooming civilizations in a galaxy floating inside a supervoid, and they are just now discovering that their island of light in the darkness is not the only one, and there are walls of galaxies surrounding them. So unbelievably far away, no one could even imagine they existed. The biggest supervoid we know of is LOWZ North 13788. It's almost 3 billion light-years in diameter. There's still about 100,000 galaxies hiding in there, but again, it's called a void because that's almost nothing compared to other regions in the universe. The observable universe itself is 93 billion light-years across, and it contains at least 100 billion galaxies. Our Milky Way alone consists of at least 100 billion stars, and it's just one pretty average galaxy inside an average cluster, gravitationally bound to superclusters and galactic walls that stretch on unimaginably long into the darkness. The size of the universe is honestly terrifying. It's so immense we can't truly understand, no matter how hard we try. Just like our little friend at the ant sitting on its tree branch can't quite see where it all begins and ends. You probably can't even tell there's other trees out there. We simply didn't evolve to be able to grasp the enormous distances in space. All our ancestors had to worry about was how far they had to walk to find food and shelter. And yet here we are. After all those centuries of stargazing and wandering, we can make a fairly decent attempt at drawing a map of, well, everything there is. The universe is the biggest thing that we know of, and our Earth is practically nothing in the cosmic scale. It's almost like we don't exist. But we can dream and feel and think and share our ideas with other people. And that has to count for something. We are almost nothing in the vastness of the cosmos, but at least we get to experience all of it. In many ways, we are lucky to live in a time that we already know so much about the universe. And we can wonder what it means to be such tiny yet conscious beings capable of experiencing and trying to understand everything there is. And I think that's meaningful. Thank you for joining me, and I hope to see you next time.